All right, you buddy.
You can.
You need to find Chinese voters.
Yeah.
Beijing, China.
You need to find.
Send a message that we're gonna quit importing their hemp and start growing our own.
Them one to Putin. Somebody said Putin, man.
Some of the solutions, society's not gonna accept them. They're hard to swallow.
Right.
But they are solutions.
Right.
But the, well, they're not gonna accept them even though, until the situation becomes so.
Are they playing our song?
Is the only way they'll ever accept it.
Butter beans.
What do you want? Fire over here.
Yeah.
Got one right here.
Is the phone plugged in today? Oh, we got a new phone. One might actually work.
Yeah, we figured one out and give us another. That's the old one there.
Been a load on it.
They're even attacking our strategies now. That's what I'm saying, views, opinions, and on strategies.
Strategies.
Guess not how we're getting good. Can you hear that? No matter, I'll tell you when you go on.
I can hear a little bit of it.
That's my problem too. Tell them who we are, Bob.
Hey, folks, welcome to the Saturday afternoon edition of the Wild Bob and Ronnie Show. We're coming to you, those folks who are watching it on the internet, we're coming to you from La Follette, Tennessee, from the offices of WLAF, 1450 AM on your radio dial, and we're very, very pleased to be here. We have a full panel of, and I say this with quotation marks, our experts, as well as we have one candidate for county office that has the guts to come out and tell you what he's thinking. And we're just pleased to have with us today, we've got Jerry Kidd, we've got myself, we have Ronnie Sharp, R.L. Henson, and we have Fred Cole, who's running for Campbell County Mayor, and we're gonna get into some nonsense here in just a minute, and but we do appreciate you tuning in here on the 19th day of July, 2014.
Okay, we're setting records. We're setting records for cold weather, Bob.
Al Gore, he talking around here somewhere?
Al Gore's probably in Sahara Desert looking for heat.
Maybe, but I figured he had a speech in Tennessee, just judging on what's going on here.
You know, I was watching something the other day, you know, they absolutely refuse to take into account the fact that the polar gas cap on Mars is melting.
Ice cap or gas cap? Gas cap or ice cap?
No, it's a gaseous ice cap. Okay, it's a frozen cap up there.
Okay.
I'm not sure exactly what it is.
I don't think you do either.
But it's melting. And it's all because of that little exploring vehicle that's running around down there. That's what's caused all of it.
I guess that's right.
Yeah.
All them Martians are driving them.
Oh, you're talking about on Mars. Oh, talk about on Mars?
Yeah.
Well, that's it. That's them there too. Little old, they got them two little.
The two of them. Yeah. They're disturbing the atmosphere and causing the polar caps to melt, you know. And there are also evidence that there is melting going on other planets in our universe. And I just wonder exactly how much human humans had to do with that.
Cornell Garwood, we're affecting everything, Bob.
You know.
If you want to call this show, it's 566-1450. Or 562-3557.
Right.
And talk to our esteemed candidate for county mayor.
You think we'll let him talk?
All right.
You sure well, wants to.
Hello, everybody. I'm Fred Cole. I'm here today with these guys whom I've known for a long time, actually. This isn't our first foray together. We've agreed on a lot of things over the years and disagreed on some. And Bob and I have even opposed each other as candidates in election. But here we are side by side. I think we were both motivated for the right reasons, just didn't get enough votes.
I agree with that.
But I'm glad to be here. I worked all day in the rain, had 37 customers come in today at the metal recycling place that I run. And
don't you know that that is not good credentials for a government job, the fact that you worked all day?
Yeah.
Folks, Fred
Look
Cole.
Look at my hands, I'm bleeding.
Fred Cole is the only candidate we've got for county mayor that holds a job in the private sector and understands and knows what private business is all about and how he can utilize the benefits of private business to help our county.
Yeah.
Is that not right, Fred? He's the only man that holds a
job. I've worked my whole life for everything I have. I didn't inherit nothing, and nobody's given me anything. So.
You know, when they talk about getting a check, you know, a lot of people consider that a career choice in this part of the country, is getting a government check. But, you know, I think William Beard and E.L. Morton has done nothing but get a check.
Well, I'm actually, three of the guys running against me are taxpayer-funded. William gets a check. Of course, he's an incumbent, and you have to understand that. But the taxpayers...
What did he do before that?
Well, he was an incumbent state representative.
And before that?
I think he worked for the farm.
He worked for the extension.
He did what his mommy told him to do. That's what William Beard did.
But,
she told him well.
She told him well.
Yeah, so that's kind of a unusual circumstance in a way, I guess. But usually the chamber, people that work for the chamber don't run for public office unless they resign or take a leave of absence or something, because it's a nonpartisan organization. And,
well, the mayor's already on the board, though.
You know, they're so
just in training.
You know, they are so nonpartisan on the Chamber of Commerce, they don't even have any business owners on the board.
They don't have nobody with any experience.
That's right. We need a businessman in office in this county.
We definitely do.
We've tried the losers on the other end of the spectrum. We need a winner on our end of the spectrum. Yeah.
Well, now, see, we have very unusual people running for office here. We have one, I'm not going to call their name, that recommended that the county take guardrail and block the entrance to Fred Cole, the business Fred Cole runs.
Okay? Yeah.
You also had another one that's running for office. They felt people ought to go and throw nails on everybody's tires that's going into that business.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I don't own that business and didn't start it, but I have run it for a year and a half. And I can tell you this, that every day I see everybody from the general to a junkie, you know, and everybody in between. Everybody recycles metal. But the vast majority of people are bringing in stuff because they need the money. Because they're struggling, they need to pay electric bills, medicine. I can tell you, I see regular folks every day, and I think if I get elected, it's the regular people in this community. They're gonna punch the ballot and get it done.
We've got at least one commissioner candidate thinks he ought to come out, or at least he had that opinion before he kind of got shot down. Want to come out and measure the height of your grass, tell you when to mow your yard.
Yeah, we also got one that wants to take signs.
That's an additional job that they can provide somebody to come around and measure your grass.
Well, I haven't thought of that. That's a job, ain't it?
Yeah, that's a job, yeah. That will go into next year's resume.
But I know you guys, I mean, people are a little bit cynical, really, about government, and for good reason. You know, I felt that way. I live here. I've lived here almost 20 years, and you know, I want it to improve.
Fred, I heard you talk about this thing about trying to, you know, like William Beard always says, job, job, job. Z.L. Morton sounds just like him. Job, job, job. We're going to bring business in here. And E.L. Morton's trying to take credit for every fast food that's come into this county in the last 20 years. And every grocery store. But I've heard you say that we need a new, fresh approach. You know, when Bush was president, 40,000 manufacturing companies moved to China. And it's hard to get a manufacturing company to come into our county. So I've heard you say that you have a fresh approach, new ideas about what we need to bring in here. So could you share some of those with us?
Well, when I think about creating jobs, and I hear everybody say, you know, I've been to all these forums here lately, and I've heard all these candidates, you know, say that we got to bring in business and industry. You know, and then you got to start thinking, well, what does that mean? You know, what kind of business and industry? How are you going to go about doing it? Right now, you know, I think we just have kind of a website that's not very impressive at all. And I think that we wait for people to come knock on our door, which isn't going to happen. The whole thing of job creation and recruiting business and industry is an extremely competitive environment. You know, we've got counties all around us, all through this region, that are competing really to trying to do the same thing. We're not alone. All rural-type counties have struggles along this line. But what I think is that you got to start looking at the big picture, you know, and where we are now. Things have changed pretty dramatically in our lifetimes, for sure, in the last 30 years, related to the type of industry that you have in rural communities. And we've tried to hold on to the old industries that are you know, dying out and have been slow to embrace an infrastructure development, been slow to embrace, you know, strengthening education or making gains and stuff like that, but really slow to embrace the new technologies that are going to be, that our kids are learning about as they're graduating. And what's happening to them is they're graduating out of high school and maybe run state or something, going on to college, a lot of them, and not coming back. So there's our brain power and our workforce there. Now, I was talking to your brother the other day, Mr. Henson, and he was talking about after school programs that you know, like mechanics, where you put a truck in there instead of going in and to the music hall and playing the flute or something. You get to go into the shop somewhere and learn about mechanics. And I talked to a guy today that's a mechanic at Rear Chevrolet. Came here, couldn't get a job. Works down there, but he's thinking about coming back up here and opening his own shop, you know. There's a lot of people interested in things other than liberal arts type education or technology type stuff, you know. It might not be their thing. So we have to have a pretty good mix of opportunities for young people as they're going through school to learn whatever turns them on, whatever. You know, everybody wants to work at a job that you're excited to go to, and probably not very many people do. You know, but you like what you do. I think we all like what we do. And that's the ideal situation. But, you know, business and industry gravitates to urban areas. You know, that's just the way it is. There's not an equal distribution of wealth throughout the country or jobs. So we got to look at, all right, what can we do to be different and carve out niche markets, maybe niche type industries that will employ the type of labor force that we have here, or how do we connect to these companies that are in the outskirts of urban areas and stuff like that, where we can do subcontracting or different things like that. Call centers and distribution warehouses and stuff, I think those are businesses that would work here, and people can learn to drive forklifts, and, you know.
You know, we're talking about educated people. We graduated, in excess of 300-some people from this county this year. Last year, the year before, and probably about the past 15 years, it's been somewhere right around 300 people graduating from our high school. Well, you know, there's not even 300 jobs available, much less the 15,000 jobs that to cover these children that were educated.
You know, William Beard's own brochure says he's only brought 172 jobs here in the last 6 years.
Yeah.
Well, how's that, how do you put 300 graduates a year into 172 jobs?
And we are producing.
Or 25 jobs a year.
Our, you know, people down our education system a lot, and I agree that it, we have where we can improve their life, but I've got 6 kids that went through Campbell County Schools, and all six of them so far are college graduates, so.
All right, how many of them are working in Campbell County?
None.
What we need.
None.
What we need is something, we need more motivation in places. Before we improve education, we need some motivation, and the way we do that is set by example. When we've got politicians that don't do anything except collect a check, you can't expect them to inspire the youth of the world to go out and strive for excellence.
I've had kids come into my store, I remember one very poignantly, a sharp-looking young man, and he was fairly sharp, you know, and we said, "How come you aren't in school?" He said, "I just don't care nothing about going." I said, "Well, boy, how are you gonna make it in life?" He said, "I'm gonna play like I'm crazy and get me a check."
Yeah.
And he was serious.
Go and check.
He was serious.
Is that how William Beard got his check, pretending to be crazy?
Did you use the word pretend?
Is that?
He got licked.
William did not have to play like he was crazy to go out yet. He didn't even have to play.
Well, you know, I have a problem with your two main competitors, Fred. I hope you don't mind if I mention one of them. Mr. E.L. Morton's running for county mayor. All I've heard him talk about is this Olympic-sized swimming pool he's gonna bring in here, but he ain't gonna use government funds. Well, we can't even raise enough money for a Boys and Girls Club, much less Olympic pool. And he's gonna bring us a bowling alley, but he didn't tell the size.
Right.
Now, if we're gonna get a bowling alley, I want Olympic-sized bowling alley.
You're talking about long bowling.
And then, the other night on WLF Forum that they had, he's gonna see that we have buoys on North Lake.
Yeah.
Now, does that buoy your election chances?
Well, wait a minute, we've only got one place. According to a local county, city councilman, we've only got one place on North Lake where you can actually access the lake, and that's down there at, where they're gonna build.
Mount Marina.
Yeah, down there where they're gonna build that there, convention center down there over the dam.
Yeah, but they'll surround it with buoys.
Oh, that's good, we don't want to run into it.
But what kind of campaign is that? Olympic-sized swimming pools, bowling alleys, and buoys.
So that's definitely creative.
Let me ask Fred, Fred, if you were mayor, and you got wind that a company by the name of Ruger Firearms was looking to relocate into Tennessee, what would you do?
I would try to set up a meeting with them immediately, but I am aware that Beretta.
Beretta, that's who it was.
Okay, Beretta, yeah, they made.
Well, Ruger moved south too.
They came to Murfreesboro.
They moved in Alabama.
Nobody followed up with them here. I know some people here that were friends with the owners, and they said that, you know, they put the county on to them, and they never followed up, but.
Well, William said he called them and sent them an email.
Fred, I'm gonna ask you a question. If you become county mayor, will you declare Campbell County an EPA-free zone so that we can bring manufacturing in here? And throw in OSHA-free zone while you're at it.
I don't think I have that.
Will you just let us proceed from the statement?
I was born in Texas, and they tried to succeed and talk to that before.
But you're saying you would develop a presentation plan, and you would fly to these companies and go to their boardrooms and meet with their boards and make a presentation of our county while they should come in.
Absolutely.
I do, I think.
Which is something William Beard.
A lot about sales.
William Beard's never done.
A lot about sales, about.
Well, he would miss his afternoon TV shows.
Yeah. But yeah, I think you do have to develop relationships, because, I mean, when they're gonna come, when they get here, and convince people, I mean, and make them be part of your story here and all. Because we have an opportunity to be, really, I think, a model for the nation.
Now, Fred, when you talk about, when you talk about relationships, Fred, aren't you familiar with some people who had a lot to do with bringing Volkswagen
in this state, and that you tried to work with them.
Yes, I did, and I'll tell you, but I'll tell you this.
You mentioned the whole idea.
We had a long-term plan there, and you guys have been, in the past have been against that centralized plan.
I am, I'm standing. To tell you how you, what you do with these.
I've never found anybody that knew more about how to run my business than I do, and if you know somebody does, we'll introduce them.
No, but in terms of like, you have to kind of get a sense of where you're gonna be 10 years from now.
That's good.
15 years from now.
Then why are we always raising taxes?
And companies and businesses, they think long-term, big companies do, they're not thinking just next year, they're thinking.
And you know what, most of their.
But that's not central planning, that's just financial budget.
Okay, all right, well, that's what we need, then, we'll call it something different.
Do you know what most of their long-term planning involves?
Right now.
How to keep the government out of their business.
Right.
Now, that's what.
How to keep making profit, because that's what businesses exist for, as we talked about.
To keep the government out of their business. Now, what you do on these companies, do exactly like Hack Ayers does. You get a bunch of people coming up here to see the villages. You get them all drunk, put them on a bus, you blacken the windows so they can't see.
I don't think Hack had anything to do with that.
They can't see what's on the way up there, and then you take them out up there and pour them out, and show them what a wonderful complex they have.
Well, there's something to that, in a way, not exactly that, but. But I was reading yesterday evening about, you know, these people are good prospects. People really would like to flee the cities, you know, up in the northeast.
Well, now, we can't have that, that's not part of the central plan. We need to consolidate them in little boxes downtown.
They're looking for a better quality of life, some of those folks, you know, and if you could convince them that, if you could provide the infrastructure that they need to communicate with the world from right here, you can attract some people. I know a guy, I hadn't met him yet, but he's a friend of somebody's. He moved here from Florida to work for a company in Knoxville, but decided that he'd live up here and commute, you know, as he needed to, but mostly he was going to be working from home. And the house that they sold him, they told him he had the internet capabilities that he needed, but once he moved in, he discovered that he didn't. So he's having to get an office space here in town somewhere. But there's a lot of people, and this guy's a bright person, you know. We can get those people. He's already said that he'll help however he can. He's probably a guy like Jerry with a lot of computer knowledge and ability and stuff. And I think that we can marshal these assets, these people assets that are here. And Cliff Jennings has talked about that some. Hello, I'm Cliff Jennings.
Right.
I had that radio voice. Tapping into some of the brain power resources that are here. And I was thinking about it the other day. It's not just.
You're talking about the godfather of the Lafollette mob.
They're genius, and there's evil genius.
Yeah, but and it's not just people that are, you know, that have run big companies and stuff like that. It's people like us that have run small companies.
Well, now, taxes have never inspired white people to start stuff.
No.
If, from what all you're saying is, and we've got tons of elected people and appointed and whatever else, that are supposed to be so well educated and experienced and all this stuff, why do we not just take them out of office and let them go into business? Since they have all this knowledge and experience, then does this make any sense?
Right.
Well, I don't know.
Let me follow this up. You got David Young down there. Bob Fannin says he's the smartest manager that he ever ran into. So why not put him out there?
Jeff Marlowe.
Or give him the opportunity, along with several others that we have elected. And then we need to change the rules as far as elected people or appointed people. And we can measure everything from whatever to whether a student makes an A, a B, a C, or whatever. Why can't we have some sort of a measure to where we can measure politicians as to whether they actually deliver or not, and deal with them accordingly, or compensate them accordingly to what they have accomplished?
Yeah.
We need more help from the local media along those lines, Mr. Henson. We're not, you know, it's like poor old Russ, Lawrence Orrick, known as Rusty. Lawrence has been the head of the jail committee. Well, that thing, what, it's almost doubled in price? And it's taken three times as long to build it, and this is our third jail that we'll have operation. And so why does the media not have this on the front page of the paper every week about these cost overruns and what a terrible job he's doing. And poor old Mr. Beard, I just think he's in over his head. You know, he was probably the second worst state representative we ever had from this area, and I'm pretty sure he's the worst county mayor we've ever had from this area. But it's the media won't point out the things that he tries to do, like when he lied to the public about that $20 million for that convention center, which was going to be 10 feet from Anderson County, that would not be on our property taxes. And the state's attorney general clearly stated, yes, our property will back that loan. Check. And William and Jeff Marlowe both lied to us about that.
Okay, check and see how many people who are on the county commission voted for that. There were several people on the county commission that approved of this, and I believe Rusty Ork is one of them.
Well, we beat it by one vote.
Well,
unlike the solar panels, we lost that one.
Commercial. Hey, folks, we're going to have a break for a commercial here. We need to, believe it or not, we need to get paid for this foolishness.
Hard to believe, ain't it?
I'm still waiting for my check.
Well, we've been in business here for 75 years. We've had 40 years experience in ambulance service. We have a Class A ambulance service.
Only 22 employees.
22 employees that we pay for all of them around.
And how much taxpayer money goes into this operation?
Absolutely nothing.
Nothing.
We do all kinds of ambulance service. We're graded by the state as a Class A service. We can haul any kind of patients. We can go anywhere. We do a lot of non-emergency transports, nursing homes, hospitals, doctor's offices. We go anywhere that patients want to go. We appreciate the opportunity to serve each and every one of our patients. Any kind of insurance you have, we're qualified to take it.
If you need medical transport, that's an ambulance, then call the company that does not require taxpayer money. They either please you or they go out of business. Call Vital Care at 562-9370. And if you can't remember that, just call 911 and tell them you want Vital Care. Works every time.
Let me ask you something, Jerry. You want me to play that there Bort's thing?
Let's hold that for a week and let Fred. Fred, I want to ask you about this issue, about this Vital Care. You know, when we have a private company providing a service in our county, why do we need to spend taxpayer dollars to compete against a private company? Wouldn't it be a lot better if we shut down this county ambulance service and let the private firm handle the whole thing? We're losing $2 million a year on this county operated ambulance service, and let the private sector handle that. It'd be like, would you want the county government to go into the metal recycling business right across the street from you?
Well, they're already in it right down the street from me.
Yeah. And that could be
We need to shut that one down too.
Yeah. It could be, that operation could be run better for sure. On the ambulance thing, you know, I'm gonna have to hear the other side of the story, and I'm gonna have to hear
philosophically, why would you want government spending taxpayer dollars on something that's provided in the private sector?
Right, government really should be building roads and running a health department. Shouldn't be really in private sector businesses competing against people that are out there trying to make a living. So I don't know about that ambulance.
Yeah, we're probably smarter than they are.
If they're losing $2 million a year
in our county, they're so dumb they use private parties to operate the ambulance service.
Yeah.
And not only do they not have to pay for the service, they also get paid for the right of this private company to operate. So we're spending about $2 million a year on our ambulance service and collecting about a million.
Well, there's no doubt that we're going to have to look at everything very closely, and we're going to have to quit building stuff.
And you'd be willing to do that.
Well, they quit pouring sand in the lake too, feller.
You know, here's the deal. When you don't have the money, I mean, there's some things that you want, things that would be nice, but, you know, everybody says, we're not going to raise, we're going to grow the economy. Well, you don't do that. You're not going to do that next month. You know, we got to deal with these issues in the next couple of months. So, I mean, the road to where we are now, we've already been down. And, you know, when I hear these guys saying, well, we're going to grow the economy. Yeah, well, that's what I want to do too. But it's not going to happen this year. It's going to take time in such a way that will solve the problems that we have, you know, because of the loss of...
Talking about that road we've been down, you know, when we can't come up with the money to pave our roads and look after them without going to an additional sales tax, it's because we're spending the money that we got coming in on things that we should not be spending them on.
Yeah, and we've also got our cities, you know, Jellicoe, and been spending some time up there, and we can't forget about those folks up there in that side of the mountain. You know, they're part of this county too. And we need to, like, try to help that city out however possible.
They went after that pie in the sky, didn't they?
Huh?
They went after that pie in the sky.
Yes, they did, but hopefully that we'll be able to salvage that in some way, someday.
You talking about that pie on Rarity Ridge?
Yeah, Rarity Mountain, because, I mean, there's a great exit there, and there's a lot of land.
Well, sure, there's a great exit to nowhere.
Yeah, it's an exit to nowhere, like the bridge to nowhere in Alaska.
$18 million, and we need roads paved here in Campbell County and La Follette
and
Jellicoe.
The one road that might have done the most good there would have been down the hill to Up Valley.
Yeah.
And it's not
there's
there.
No way. Yeah. It's impossible. Yeah. Well, I'll take that back. Anything is possible.
Yeah.
But that goes right straight off of a cliff, right down the mountainside.
Well, they had it planned out there at one point where they were going to put a connecting road right down through
there. It'd be good for the hang gliders. They'd go down and pick up their man or what's left of him.
Yeah, but the cities need to. I've talked to a couple of the mayors, and you know, there's been no real effort on the county's part to bring the cities together to work on whatever it is that we can work on together to make things better around here. But, you know, I think that's what you got to do is you got to get out of the office. I mean, I'm a people person. I will be in that office as much as I have to, but I'll be out with folks too. I want to have town hall meetings. I mean, that's just the nature of who I am. I like to hear from people, and I like to mingle with people. The regular people, you know, I can put on a suit and mingle with the cream of society, but I like to.
Will you have an assistant county? Will you have an assistant county mayor that will do all your work?
Well, there'll be somebody there to help me. I mean, it's going to be a tough job. I've never run a government before, so you know, I'm going to have a little bit of a learning curve. But I'm smart. And, you know, I think that we can apply private sector type thinking to government as much as possible. I mean, there's a difference between government and private sector.
You know, Ronnie, I believe it was, said, why don't you put these people that know everything that's in government out to do private industry?
That's all right.
Let me mention, David Young put Love Mobile Home Company out of business by ruining it. He also put the satellite company out of business, and then he also failed in his own construction company. Hey, what about Ronnie?
Hey, everybody's got concerns about Campbell County, but nobody's doing nothing about it. All they want is some money.
Well, we got a candidate now who really wants to make a change, and he comes out of the private sector, and I think he could help this county out a lot.
I'll tell you. I'm solely motivated by a desire for public service. I don't have any agenda. I don't owe anybody anything. I haven't promised anybody anything. I think that I'll be in the best position, really, to do what's right. And what's right is going to be hard, and people aren't going to like it in some cases. But, you know, I mean, that's just the reality that we face right now.
Okay. Let me ask you something, Brad. How many people you got running for county mayor?
Five.
All right. How many of you think would be running today if that job did not pay anything?
Well, Probably nobody.
Five?
That's a full-time job like that, you gotta.
You still have five.
Make a living, too.
You still have five.
Let me ask a question.
There'd be two or three in there, one could go and help the people, the others still be helping themselves.
Let me ask a question then. As far as the pay is concerned, every county mayor in the state, do they get paid the same?
Well, I don't think so, but I believe it is set by the legislature, because here's the deal. Last time I ran, I went and talked to Jeff Marlowe about it. I asked him if would there be any way that I could like take some of the salary that you pay me and put it into salaries for some people that would work with me. Because like right now, I think the deputy mayor's, you know, he's only making about 32 or 33,000 or something.
Well, that's a little bit of.
I mean, that is good.
Okay.
That's good, but you know, I mean, when you.
That's a little bit less than he is making off that last job he got run off of.
The county is a big corporation, basically. It's like running a big business, and you need to, if you're gonna have talented people, you need to be willing to pay them at least close to what they can get in the private sector.
You should be able to fire them more often, too.
I wanted to give up part of my salary to up some of their salaries. And he said that I wouldn't be able to do that because the salary's set by statute.
Okay, this is.
Oh, the county supplement can vary.
Here's what I'm coming back to. These salaries are set by other people who are on salary. And somewhere in here, I'm seeing a problem. I think somehow we should have some sort of a ratio to where that all salaries are set in accordance to what the mean income or the average income plus so much of the county is, to where that it's attached to it, to where that what people do that who are in positions are directly affected by whether the county is successful or whether it's bringing in or taking out or whatever, and hook their compensation to something. I mean, just like the mayor right now, I don't think he has to show up, what is it, once or twice a month or something like that?
Yeah.
I mean, legally?
Right.
Okay. This is where that I'm gonna start calling us grunts. We're the grunts out here. And we're getting took to the cleaners and by our elected officials. And I believe you could probably tell me what the salary is right now of the county mayor here in the county.
60,000, isn't it?
No, it's around 80.
Around 80.
He just got a raise recently.
But that's just the salary, not counting the compensation.
Well, he didn't.
Okay. David Young, the contract he had with the city of La Follette, if I can remember correctly, he was getting about $14,000 a year put into some sort of a retirement thing. And I think that's pretty close. Now, these are the type of things that you don't ever hear about in salary. He's putting more at that position, and most people are earning here.
Right.
But anyhow, where you've got all these elected people, where their salary is being just set and not connected to nothing, it's I don't know how you say it. If you're in business, and let's say call this is a business, if we're going to call the county a business, then if it's losing money, then its CEOs ought to be losing money too.
Right.
It would change their attitude.
Yes. You know, when I was a young man, I was thinking about this. I had a couple different jobs where I worked in the cabinet shop one summer where we made furniture, and you worked peacetime. The faster you worked, the more you did, the more you got paid. I worked in a broom factory there where and every day, you know, your hands would be in that corn that they used to wind brooms and all the stitch things together. That was peacetime work, too.
Kind of like Berea.
You know, and
my first job at Berea.
There's nothing you can really do about those salaries around here.
Yes.
From the state level, it would have to be addressed from the state level on those things. You know, but here's what we need to get away from. We need to get away from people thinking that government's going to provide me with a job. And that's the government is the biggest employer here, I think, with the school system and the rest of the government. You know, and a lot of people ask for government jobs all the time, try to get government jobs. Because once you get that job, you're pretty safe. Until now, I think things are going to be a little bit more unsafe. But, you know, I think that we need to cross-train. I didn't think that, you know, there might be three people doing what one person can do. I don't know. We'll have to get into it and see.
Okay, whenever we talk about unions, I heard a guy, he came into, just as an example, to make a, to do a welding demonstration at the shop, and he was explaining to me how he'd come from Oak Ridge, and he was going to do a welding demonstration. They had to call a guy from somewhere else to pick the piece of metal up and to put it in the vise, and whatever. They had about three or four people that had to be involved, and it took about three or four times as much time. And I think this is a whole lot of what's running in our country. And another thing is regulations. This country wasn't built on regulations. It was built, and then all these stupid regulations come along with it. And at the last election, we could have, the county commission could have voted to opt out of building codes.
Right.
Now, coming up after this election, they've got so many meetings, I think it's one or two, to opt out of building codes. Now, there's something that I'd be curious, interested in, is to why do we need building codes and go through four or five inspections? I can see the electric and the sewer, but everything else is nothing more than jobs and money. And if I'm building, if let's say that a bank is going to furnish the money to build a building, let them take care of this bill. Or, like Ronnie suggested years ago, if you're going to build a building, a house, residential, now I'm not talking commercial, a residential house, let's say you want to build it and you don't want to have an inspector there, you put it on the deed. Or if you want it built by a certain code, it be put on the deed. This house was built according to certain codes. And if you want to, if you want it inspected, hire your own inspector who you can hold accountable for what goes on. Right now, if you build a building in the county, inspector don't show up, you have to go ahead and proceed because of weather or whatever. You take a picture of the footers or whatever, you proceed. If it falls down, you cannot go back on the county inspector, no way whatsoever. If you've got a private inspector that you paid for and that you chose, you can go back and hold him accountable. What is wrong with what I'm saying?
Well, it would have, there has to be some protection for somebody that's going to buy that house down the road.
What, and okay, that's
what you say.
That's what I'm saying. Put it on the deed. Right.
Yeah.
So there's their protection. Or put the name of the company who did inspect it, and they're still protected.
Right.
But why have the government come out here and charge us untold whatever they want to set the rate at? And I still believe in a free country, and I believe if you're going to pay for it, and you're going to build it and it falls down tomorrow, it's not costing nobody but you. So you would be allowed to make a mistake. Now, the way we're setting this up, we're setting it up to where you're not allowed to make a mistake in this country. And this country hasn't been built that way. This country has been built over mistakes.
You know.
So what is wrong, basically, with what I'm saying?
Well, you gotta provide for protection for...
in government buildings.
In government buildings.
But or a public building, like a bank.
Have some faith and confidence in the house that he's buying, that something will fall in on his kids. Yeah. Even the guy that's building it, you know, should be concerned that it's not going to fall in on his kids. You know, that they're living there too.
And
the problem has been that there's been substandard construction.
Okay, but
kind of like the pyramids, they were not okay.
But what the point I'm getting back to. How did this country ever survive? How did we build log cabins out here in nowhere whenever the pioneers come to this country? And you're saying that they have to be protected.
What about
toilet paper? Do we have to protect them from that?
It's like a lemon a car or something.
Okay.
You know, in a way, you know, it's protection for the future.
I remember when a lemon was an acceptable risk.
But if you buy a bad car, you can go back on the manufacturer of it.
Right.
When you buy a house, if it's listed there on the deed that it was built by this and inspected by this company, where's the guarantee when you buy a lottery ticket?
Well, where's your the guarantee when the county inspected it? You go back on the county and yep. inspected it. Go back and sue the county and see where that gets you.
You can't do that.
No.
But what I'm saying is you should be allowed to take a risk if you're paying for it. If you want to buy a lottery ticket or if you want to buy a house that's not been inspected or whatever, that should be part of the American dream, but you can do it. Because I know of a lot of people who have built a structure to inhabit that wouldn't meet no kind of codes, but it's still standing. And it's
the roof
didn't leak. The thing didn't fall down, but if it had of, It would have been their responsibility. But they didn't have to go to the bank and borrow an untold amount of money. They didn't have to have it built within so many days. They could do it as they could afford it and is, and stay out of debt.
Yeah, I've seen, I was raised around houses like that all the time where people built them over a period of years.
You tell me, here in this area, some of the most desirable homes that are for sale were built before building codes were in effect.
We got different points of views on that, but your point of view mainly is that it's not really, it's not the government's business to come in and tell me what I can do with mine.
Well, I'm also saying that it's not the government's responsibility to protect me from taking a risk. You can, there's all sorts of risks you can take, but this is one that they can milk money out of. Now, you tell me, when was the last time you heard of a house collapsing in this area? And I only know of one building collapsing, and it was due to the fact that they was taking it down and something went wrong. But I'm talking about a house that just collapsed and killed a dozen kids or even one.
You don't hear about that much, but that you do hear about, you know, different kinds of problems
Where have you heard about most of those problems from? Subdivisions which were supposed to have been inspected even
that
before we had this building code.
Most
of them were in subdivisions that the government was supposed to have inspected before we come up with these programs.
Yes.
We got another commercial coming up, folks, so let's hang loose.
Vaughn Digger Wilson. He's been here off and on for over 30 years in the same spot. Pumping propane, doing repairs on containers, heaters. I got one in the county that'll do you a repair on your tanks if you need it. I sell propane gas, liquid propane, and I've got plenty of competitors, and I can easily compete with them. That's grills, backup heat, substitute heat, grills, campers, motor homes, you name it. And if it comes in through that door, I can take care of it. I'm here Tuesday through Friday, 8 to 5, and Saturday, 8 to 12. They could call me at 562-54-44.
What was that?
54-44.
562-54-44.
54-44.
Yeah. And get your flavored propane.
Yeah, I mean, I'm all in favor.
He still got some of that red, white, and blue 4th of July propane left.
Okay.
The less government, the better.
Fred, go ahead.
Less the government.
Excellent statement.
Probes around in my personal life and tries to tell me how I'm going to live my life better. Believe me, they poked around in my life in the past.
I think you had a little re-education lately, ain't you?
But I'll tell you, you know, you're right. The private sector should take care of as much as possible.
Going by the same scenario as to where the government, excuse me just a minute. If the government should inspect houses and whatever, I know of equipment where you go to buy one piece of equipment probably costs more than two or three houses. Why should the government not protect us then? If they're going to protect the citizens out there, why shouldn't the government not come in and inspect every piece of equipment to be sure that you're not going to get burned on it, or that you, and let me back up and say
one
other thing.
Well, that's because you don't have equipment owners on the county commission. You got real estate agents on it.
Okay, and banks. See, the bank is the one that really profits from this thing. this adds to the cost of the house by significant amount. All this inspection does. Okay, when you go to finance it, you're financing that inspection as well.
Right, and appraisal.
Whenever this thing came up, the place had several bankers down there pushing for this building codes thing. So there's another thought I've got, and I've lost my chain of thought on it. But anyhow, we've took a lot of your time on this.
Also, if you build without an inspection, a lot of times you don't have to finance it, period.
Well, I can show you all sorts of things too. When you go to build a building or a structure, you may not have, you may change your mind as you go along. You may come into a, you may have won a lottery, you want to change the way you do it. And I'm being hypothetical here. But what I'm saying to a certain extent is, the system is set up to where that the person on the bottom never gets any further than the bottom. You suck him into financing, you suck him into everything else, and there's a few people out there that are willing to do it the old way. I mean, pay as you go, put in your own sweat equity into it, and whatever. And now I'm going to spin off into something else that you just said about a fella who would be interested in coming back here as a mechanic. There's oodles of small businesses that this community doesn't have, and the reason I feel they don't have it is it is so regulated that you cannot hardly start into business. A person starting out here, by the time they buy all the permits, the regulations, the certifications, and everything else, they can never get started. And you mentioned something else a minute ago. You mentioned a forklift. People could run a forklift. Right now, you're supposed to be certified to run a forklift. A forklift goes forward, backwards, up, and down, and that's it. But yet, you got to be certified. Now, this is where I'm coming back to grunts. Who taught all these old boys, teenagers out here, to drive strip trucks and strip pits and logging woods? It's the grunts taught the grunts. And then the grunts are paying the taxes on it. And this is where we're getting into all stuff. Now, I'll agree, they've been people hurt in accidents. But they can get hurt. I heard Elk Ridge. Well, I won't even get into that. But there's people gets hurt everywhere, every day. But the grunts teach the grunts how to survive. It's not out here in a book. No. But yet, this world is not going to turn without us, the people out here in the ditches, digging the ditches and shoveling the poop and whatever else. Everybody goes to school, or the majority of people go to school to get an education, and I've never got the definition yet of an education, but yet they don't intend to sweat, bleed, and whatever, and do the extra hours, work a 24 or a 40-hour shift or something to survive. And that's where I'm coming from on this thing.
You're educated. Third grade? But not all education is learned in school.
There's very few.
I mean, you survive. You learn how to survive.
When I was in the third grade, when I finished the third grade, I already knew everything I needed to survive.
Yeah, most people are that way when they're adults.
Well, I'm telling you.
He was shaving in the third grade, wasn't he?
In the third grade, most people that are in positions of authority, just like what I'm going to say, like your county people are elected to positions. The only thing they can decide is if one number is bigger than the other. And a third grader knows if a two or a three, which one's the largest. Excuse me, go ahead.
Well, Bob, Ronnie.
Hello, Bob. Y'all got an interesting show going on.
Thank you.
Discussing a lot of common sense stuff, and makes a lot of sense. But you're sending it out in the radio land, and as a listener, I just wanted to tell you briefly what a listener is hearing. You all seem to be backing this candidate and hoping for something better than what you've got, and I understand that. But a candidate that can't answer a point-blank question when asked whether private ambulance service business versus taxpayer service ambulance service business, and you can't answer that question, it seemed like he hedged a little on that. And experience has taught us when the candidate gets to hedging a little bit that he's not ready to go on record or make a commitment. And you all are in this for the betterment of Campbell County, and so you need a candidate that will listen to common sense and good reason, and I'm not seeing this one do this, although you all are throwing out a lot of common sense and good reason. I just wish you the best on it, and thought I'd tell you what just one listener's hearing on this beautiful Saturday afternoon. Good program. Thank you.
Thank you for calling, man.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Appreciate you.
Like I said before, I've never run a government. I don't know all the details about the ambulance situation. And so if you want to call it hedging, you can call it hedging. But I can't sit here and say that I'm going to close the ambulance service or keep it open, because I don't know. You know, I would sit down with the people involved and the commissioners and the other people and figure out, you know, like you say, is it worth it to the taxpayers to do this?
Let me ask you one question. Would you pledge to spend the county money the same way you spend your own money?
Yes, I would. Like today.
What about money?
Yes. Jack needs to vote for Jack West, buddy.
Yeah, Jack's a good guy. I told him the other day he'd make a great deputy mayor.
Who's that?
Jack Lentz.
Well, you know, what I was going to say, you know, the deputy mayor you got has already put three businesses out of business, you know, and that's the only way he can make a living is to work for the government, you know, or work against it, which he got caught doing that.
Well, I've tried to ask over and over. I know my friend Jerry Chadwell gets real upset with me. Is what has E.L. Martin ever done for this county? Now, Jim Slusher's trying to say that he's done a lot, but he's making claims that he can't back up. And I just think we got a candidate here that works in the private sector who has experience with private business. And I love his response to Ronnie's question just a moment ago. Would you repeat that again, Ronnie?
I said, would you pledge to spend the taxpayers' money the same way you'd spend your own money?
Well, I think so. You know, I mean, that's my orientation. I know today I saw where I got charged twice by Food City for gas, and I knew that right then.
You do realize that when you're spending your own money, you realize that it's not a bottomless and endless supply.
I had a thought on that a while ago, actually. You know, when you are in government, and I've seen it, you know, we've all seen it in the military, particularly, where, you know, let's just spend it because we have it there. You know, it's just good. It's not like it was ours. That's a mentality in government. It's not like it was ours, but it is ours, you know. And I think that comes from people spending a long time in government and nobody ever really holding them accountable for how they do spend money.
Folks, well, we got about 3 minutes left. Do we want to give Fred a couple of minutes to sum up?
Go ahead and say what you
We got. Sure do appreciate you, Kane.
Let's get you as far over here. What about money? Hey!
They're gone. They didn't know what they wanted to do. Fred, it's yours for closing time.
Well,
yeah.
I've been a citizen of this community for 20 years almost, and I've been involved in the sausage making, you know, to the delight of some and to the, you know, some people don't like me very much. But I've always been trying to advance things that I thought were good for the community and thought that we would, you know, that I've seen in other areas. And that's one of the things I'll do as county mayor. I mean, I'm going to scour the universe to try to find stuff that works here. And I've heard EL saying, you know, we're going to have people from Campbell County, just people from Campbell County. Well, you know, two of the five people here are not from Campbell County in this group, and that's basically the population. We got to bring everybody to the table.
Three. Bob's North Carolina.
Well, I know Bob, but
we got to count you.
Scott, I'm from Scott County.
All right, okay. But anyway, you know, I think I've always felt like there was things that we could do better, and I've been embarrassed by the way government has been run in the past and some of the, you know, ways that politicians have really embarrassed us and haven't really created the kind of, when people are looking to come to a place to locate a business and all, they'll spend a week looking at the newspaper too, or two or three, or for a while they'll go around and they'll figure out. Pretty soon they figure out that this, you know, they can find better down the road. We need a government that works together and gets things done. And we haven't had that much in the past. We've only got a minute left. But I would appreciate, you know, I've got a TV show on Wednesday night.
We've enjoyed having you. We hope that you may come back again between now and time of the election.
Sure.
You
know,
come back after you're elected, too.
I will.
Don't have that.
I will.
And folks,
don't vote.
Yeah, but don't vote too early because who you voted for passes away. You don't get to change.
You can vote two or three times for free.
Thank you very much.